wanna be the very best, like no one ever was. To catch them is my real test, to train them is my cause. No, I will travel across the land, searching far and wide. No, no, teach the Pokemon to understand the power that's inside. Pokemon, gotta catch them all, so true, yeah. Our courage will pull us through, and you'll teach me, and I'll teach you, Pokemon. Gotta catch them all.
Hey everyone, this is Dave from the Adobe Character Animator team, and lately I've been experimenting a lot with taking a cartoon head and putting it on top of a real life person. So it's a merging of not quite animation, not quite reality, but combining them together to create something unique. And it's a really cool technique that helps you stand out from the crowd. So in this tutorial, we're gonna walk through how to do this. First, the rigging and recording and editing of the head performance in Character Animator, and then moving into Adobe After Effects to do the motion tracking, color correction, and all of that. Should be a fun tutorial, so let's get started. So let's start off in Character Animator. I created this head in Adobe Fresco and then brought it into Photoshop, organized all the layers, imported into Character Animator, and I was ready to go. Of course, you can use Fresco, Photoshop, Illustrator, anything that can make a PSD or AI file and bring it in. A few things to note about this head. Number one, notice how as I move around, it's kind of pivoting from one spot. It's not moving all over the place. And there's a couple of reasons for that. Number one, I do want to make sure that when I track this on a human neck later on, I don't want the head moving all over the place. I want it to just kind of rotate from a central place. And there's a couple of things I did with that. Number one, under the face behavior, under head position strength, I changed that to 0. If this was 100, like it is, I think by default, notice how much the head is moving back and forth, and that's gonna be really hard to line up later on. So you wanna make sure that that is set to 0. You can also play around with head tilt strength. I think this is set to 75 by default. I changed it to 45 just to bring it down a little bit, but play around with whatever head tilt settings look best to you. The second thing I did is in rig mode, I took my head group, so this group labeled head that has all the head components inside of it, and I took that origin and dragged it down to the bottom here so it pivots from the neck. You don't want it pivoting from like up here or the middle or anything like that. Let's see how it looks when I put it in the middle. And notice now that the chin and the top of the hat and all of that is moving because it's pivoting as if there was a pivot point right down the middle of the head. And again, this is gonna be hard to line up when I'm trying to line up this chin to the neck in After Effects. So a much better way to do things is to drag this down to the bottom over here. And now my head is instead pivoting from the chin, the neck area. And that's again gonna make it a lot easier to line up later. I would highly recommend seeing if there's places where you can add physics to your character. So I've turned off the physics for now. And when I move my head back and forth, it looks fine, but it feels like it's missing a little bit of extra life. The hair is kind of just flat. And that's gonna really help make the character, it's not gonna feel as alive as it could be. So by adding some physics to the hair and playing around with the settings a little bit, I get a little bit of extra bounce to the hair as I move back and forth. And particularly when you're bouncing along to a song or something like that, this is gonna add a lot of extra life to the character. And it's just one of those secondary animations that you just set it and then you don't have to think about it anymore. I also wanted to make sure that I had a nice variety of triggers. I don't want this character just blankly staring into the abyss at all times. So I added a few different triggers. One will change the mouth to be the more sad mouth. And this was great for the song because there's some parts where he felt happier. There's some where he was concentrating more. And switching it between these felt like it added a lot of range of emotion. Same thing with the eyes. I wanted to show a lot of different eye triggers. So I have 2 to make them like this, 3 to be a little happier, 4 to do the half eyes, and then 5 was a manual blink. I didn't want to do the auto blink. I wanted to manually, at a few times, have him close his eyes like that and come back out. And then finally, I just wanted a little bit more control over my eyebrows. So I added some eyebrow triggers as well. So 6 will make them go down like that, and then 7 will make them raise up. So a quick note on the recording process for a character like this, where I was doing a musical performance. I just recorded, myself playing the guitar live on my iPhone. And then that was not a great audio track to do the lip sync from, though, because the guitar is competing with the voice. And so Character Animator was having a really hard time trying to pick up, okay, is this a syllable you're saying, or a guitar strum, or whatever? And the guitar was competing, the noise of the guitar was competing with the voice and just making it really difficult to get a nice clear signal. So instead, what I did is listen through headphones to that recording and then make a new recording singing along to it, so I get all the timing just right, but I get a nice clear audio signal. And then that is what I brought in, imported here into Character Animator, dragged it into my scene, and then did the usual timeline, compute lip sync, take from scene audio to get all my different mouse shapes and get all the lip sync looking exactly like I wanted. And to be honest, that was the only thing that I took from the video. A lot of you ask, oh, can I take, you know, are there ways to bring my video footage in and do the tracking based off of that? There are ways. You can make virtual cameras through apps like ManyCam and CamTwist and stuff like that. But honestly, I feel like you get more control just focusing and doing the performance on your own. So what I ended up doing was a typical recording pass where I did the lip sync first, got all my mouse shapes, I fixed, you know, little changes here and there, and then I turned them off and then focused, you know, just on my face performance. And so I'd move back and forth, you know, to the beat of the music, sometimes flip my head back and forth when it was a particularly a strenuous part or something he was really concentrating on. And then once I was done with that, moved on to something like the eye gaze. I think I did keyboard input for this instead of camera input, so I had a lot more control over where those eyes were looking at any given time. And then finally, I probably finished up with triggers and did all my different trigger recordings. And you can see here in my triggers, I really only recorded one track. So I press record, do the best I could with the triggers for the mouth, changing from the alt mouth to the regular mouth or the different eyelid positions, and then go back and edit and add them or change the timing as I saw fit. So I don't have multiple tracks of triggers, you know, this big staircase effect. I just kept it simple, kept it to one, and I can, you know, of course, move these earlier or later by dragging here. Or if I wanted to make a new trigger, I can just go to edit split, and that is going to create a new trigger here. And then I could say, okay, now I want the eyeballs, you know, I want them to be in this up position instead, and just play around with it. Usually for this, I was changing it between lines. So, you know, as he was reaching a certain part or line, he kind of changed his expression, changed his emotion. And I use that audio to drive everything. All right, so I'm here in After Effects and I've imported my original video. You can see I'm looking off the screen, reading the lyrics and chords, but I'm gonna hide that fact later with the cartoon face over top of this. So I've imported that, and then I've also imported the CH project file. If you import a CH proj file, you're going to get all of that stuff just dynamically linked. I don't have to do any additional rendering step or anything like that. So it saves me a lot of time. All right, so I'm gonna take my footage. I'm gonna drag it into the create new composition icon down here. And that's going to give me a new composition, new fresh timeline that I can begin to work with. Before I move on, I'm going to go to layer, new, null. This is gonna give me an invisible object that I'm gonna use later to help track the motion. So I just need to set that up right now. So I've got a target. Now that I've got my footage selected here, and mine's a Premiere Pro file, yours could just be the video itself, but I did a little bit of editing and audio sweetening in Premiere Pro before bringing it in. And now with this selected, I'm going to go to my tracker area over here and make sure I'm at around 0, 0, and I'm going to go to track motion. All right, and now I've got this little track point that if I click the middle here, I can drag around and put wherever I want. In the past, I've tried all sorts of different tracking points. I've done my nostrils, for example. I've done freckles on my face. I've done put a piece of tape on me and all that stuff. But think about it this way. Right now, if we just want the face to be flat over top of this, we want to find a point probably pretty close to the neck, because that's what we're going to be tracking. If I track the head, I tend to move my head and like look down, look all around in different directions. Like if I tracked my nostril, it might be moving in all sorts of different directions, and it might be a little trickier for me to get the exact tracking that I want. So instead, what I'm going to do is drag it down and find a spot around the neck area that pretty much follows the movement of the neck. It doesn't have to be on the neck itself. In fact, the one that I used for this was the top of this little zipper right here. This was a good enough track point that it worked for 99% of the track, and I only had to do a few manual edits. So I'll show you what I mean. If you've never done motion tracking before, it's pretty easy. So I select this, I have it where I want it to go, and then I click over here in the tracker area. I'm going to click the play button for maybe a couple seconds. Okay, so it was pretty good, but at a certain point, it loses the track. Something didn't work out. So what I'm gonna do is try that again. And then right here, when it starts moving fast and gets rid of doesn't quite catch up with the tracking, I'm gonna start using the frame forward button instead. And just go one frame at a time until I see maybe a problematic area where it loses the track. And if I see a point where it's not quite lining up, I will just move this to the correct spot. And then once I've made that manual adjustment, I try clicking play again and seeing if it works. And yeah, it does seem to be tracking pretty well. So I'll stop, then I'll press play again. And if it did mess up, I would just stop Command Z or Control Z to go back and then do the frame by frame thing to find where it messes up, readjust it, click play again, and continue. So this is like a 52 second piece, I think, something like that. And so I am going to go through the whole process of tracking this and getting all the tracking data I possibly can. All right, once I'm happy with my tracking data and how it's looking, I've looked at every frame and it seems like it's always following this point. I'm gonna go ahead and go to Edit Target and just make sure it's selecting the correct layer. So if you have any other layers on here, you might wanna make sure it's set to your null layer, that invisible layer that we created ahead of time. That looks good, so I'm gonna go ahead and click OK. And now I want to apply this to the null. Basically what that's gonna do is analyze all of this and turn it into keyframes and make the null move the exact same way. So let's try that. So I'm gonna go ahead and click apply and okay. And now I can close this extra zoomed up window. I don't need that. I can get back to my composition. And now if I twirl open my null layer, look what's happened. A transform track has been added with a position keyframe for every single point of the track. Right? And so everywhere that it is, if I zoom in here again, really way too close to my neck, I can see that this track point is following exactly every frame here. So that's really helpful. Now I have a point of reference that I can connect other things to move around with it at the same time. So let's take the CH project file of Ash's head here that I got and drag it in over top of my composition, line it up, whatever I think is a good starting position, something like that. And now what I can do is go ahead and use the pick whip tool down here to connect that CH project asset to the null layer. So now I can see as I play this back that the head is moving with the rest of the body. This just gives it a more realistic, grounded look. I could try to, you know, manually keyframe it and always hide the head, but it's always going to look a little disconnected. It's always going to look a little bit better if you try to connect it like this. Now you may run into some points where some of the head is visible underneath and it didn't, you know, quite track, or the zipper is moving a little bit too much and it's not quite working out, and that's okay. What you can do is go to a part where it is okay and then do some additional manual keyframes with your CH project file to move it by itself. So if I press P here to get a position keyframe, I'm gonna go ahead and click on that and set this how I think it looks good. And then if I moved on and I saw a part that I didn't really like, let's say I needed to adjust this higher or lower, I can just go ahead and do that and then review the in-between steps to make sure that there's no gaps or no places where the rest of the face is pushing through. And then if I saw another one, maybe I'd set another keyframe here. And then if I did see a mistake, I can always adjust it as need be. So this was the final piece, and you can see how many additional of these little manual keyframes I added just to slide the head back and forth and get it in the right position at any given time. So your mileage may vary. You might get everything. Your head might not move around or bob as much as mine does when I'm playing guitar, or your characters might be a little more stationary, so it might be a little easier, but that's basically how it works. Now for a finishing touch, I did a little bit of color correction. So the colors here and the face are really bright and colorful and cartoony, and the rest of the camera is a little bit muted. So I could play with saturation, I could do some other things, but what I ended up doing was a trick where I take the RGB values of the head and I change them to match what's in the camera. So the way I'm gonna do that is make sure my Character Animator project artwork, the head file, is selected. And then I'm going to go to Effect, Color Correction, Levels, Individual Controls. That's going to open up my levels over here, and I'm going to go channel by channel and change it to match basically what I'm looking at here. So I'm going to go to the red channel here by clicking the little channel drop down here and going to red. And then in my little three thing here that says the show, the channel and color management settings, I'm going to click on that and also change it to red. So this is basically showing me all the values that red currently has. And I can see that the head is still kind of showing up a little bit more, right, than it should be. It's taking up, it looks a little brighter as compared to the rest of this. So I might adjust this a little bit more to get it looking more in line with what I think this might look like correctly. So I might play around with, you know, some of these other sliders, change the darkness, change the lightness, until I feel like it's got the right tone that I'm looking for. It's not too bright, it's not too dark. It feels like it just fits in. So something like that's looking good to me. And then I can move on into each individual channel. I've already done these, but I'll show you. I go to green and then to the green and make sure those look like they're lined up correctly. And then blue and blue, and make sure those look pretty good. And then you can go back to RGB and this back to RGB, and the face looks a lot more connected to the rest of the scene. It's not perfect, but you know, I also brought in some human saturation and brought the saturation down as well. But you can play around with it and see what works best for you. So if I turn the effect off, you can see here was the face we began with, a little too bright. Here's the face that's more integrated into the scene. Now, this is a really subtle difference, and not, you know, too many people are gonna notice it, but it's a nice finishing touch that's gonna make your work look slightly more polished. And then just to help bring everything together a little bit more, I brought in this watercolor texture that I've used in almost 50% of the tutorials on this channel. And I brought down the opacity to something like 50 and made an overlay of that. And that just gave it, I felt like, a nice kind of warm look to the whole thing and a little texture on it, which I felt helped it, you know, just feel like it all came together. So hopefully this gives you a good idea of what's possible with mixing Character Animator and After Effects. I've shown some pretty simple examples here, but you can imagine a whole show where you've got people with cartoon heads walking around and talking to each other and doing a whole sitcom type thing. The sky is the limit, and you know, whatever you can imagine, you can put together. So I just think of it this way. I do all my character animation inside Character Animator, and then all the compositing, effects, color correction, all of that extra stuff in After Effects. And when you know how to use both of those two, the world's your oyster. It is pretty cool what's possible. All right, that's it. Thanks for watching. And we've got a little cameo here from our new puppy, 9 weeks old, Caramel. She is a Cavalier King Charles Spaniel, and she's a big fan of animation, Character Animator, all that stuff. What do you think? Yep. So anyway, if you have anything you'd like to share with Character Animator, please use hashtag Character Animator on social media so we can find it. And if you run into any issues or problems about this tutorial or any other issues in Character Animator, the best place to get help is the official Character Animator forums. That's it for today. Thank you so much for watching, and have fun.